You're listening to Paint the Town podcast with your hosts, LA Street Art Gallery resident artist, teacher, and founder of LA Street Art Gallery, James Chen of
Happy 420, bro.
Happy 420, man. I figured today would be a good day to do this. I have an announcement to make. I've decided to stop smoking.
Really?
Yeah, dude. I mean, you know, I'm 51 now, and, you know, it's just getting too old for this stuff, you know?
I'm going to keep on smoking, though. It's 420 today, after all, so.
Dude, I'm just kidding. April Fools.
nobody's in the mood for April Fools this year on April 1st,
you know what I mean? I know. This was, in my entire life, this is like the first one where there was just like, no, none. Like, yeah, it was just not the time for April Fools at all.
Well, we have a very special show today because, I mean, we have two guests today, kind of like on the 420 tip, right, you know? And usually we do our shows on Tuesday, actually. But today, since it's 420, we're going to have Dave Navarro calling in to join us later. Or should I say life after death, basically, right?
Life after death street, yes. Yeah, this is what he's wanting to, transverse into.
And today, it's going to just be a little bit more of a stoner show. So we're going to have my friend Domo Monster, otherwise yes. known as Onyx Muse. She's a webcam model coach. And she's also a previous bud tender, and it's something that she's been what do you call it?
She was actually there to support me in my very first art show.
Exactly, man. And I mean, you know, she's in the cam world, she's been in the porn world, you know, she's been in the stripping world. So we figured it'd be a good 420 show today, man. You know, to bring her on as a guest, and so. Looking forward to that, man. That'll be happening at 3 p.m. Pacific time. But right now, basically at 11 o'clock, we're going to date our life after death call in and join us for the show. Hopefully he has his weed smokes ready, basically. I've smoked some bowls with him in the past, and, hopefully he'll be on video today so he can show us around his studio too, man.
Yeah, that'd be cool. You know, he might be doing... the same thing that I was talking about, you know, maybe he decided to stop smoking today. You know, he likes to try different things, different ways of, medicating.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of the things I like about him. You know, he's always, trying, you know, different, mediums and stuff like that. And, you know, that's how he made the move from just doing music to doing street art. And, now he's just fully encased in, you know, street art. He's obsessed with it. I love it.
Yeah, man. I love it too. Like, talk about dedication and just coming on. I mean, actually, I realized last year, 420, we had our 420 sellout show, remember? Which turned out to be a fucking disaster at the end of the day, right? I mean, if you don't know, last year we had a 420 art show. The cops ended up rolling up on this shit. And then, I ended up getting a ticket for an art show, man. So, like, it's just like...
Yeah, they're trying to cart your ass off, dude. They're like, okay, get this guy. This is the guy who's in charge. You know, move him over here. Get him away from everybody. And, you know, four cops. Big old guys. They're some big, hefty guys. And, you know, it was a little bit of a racist situation, you know? Because they came in and they saw all these people, and it just so happened that same day there's a modeling business in your building that was throwing an event also, and it's a Chinese modeling agency, and you know, they just
there's a lot of people there at that building, basically, that day.
Well, they found out that it was a Chinese person that owned the building, and, you know, everything was, you know, Chinese related. And so then when they found you, they were like, okay, this is the guy that's in charge and is responsible for everything. And
And they basically just try to cart me off, man. But you know what? What it's cool about it is that after, like, I actually just finished the court case, I think, in January, man. You know what I mean? And so almost a year later, I mean, $2,500 just for a lawyer fee for a little bit, you know, up my street cred a little bit in the art game, I think, though, right?
Oh, dude, come on. Yeah, I mean, you got a ticket and almost carted off for, to jail for throwing an art show. That's, you know, for graffiti artists. I mean,
this is awesome. The on the ticket that I have, it literally says art show, man. And I don't think, I don't know. I'm just saying how many people.
No, wait, actually, it says art show on the ticket?
Yeah, it says art show on the fucking ticket, dude. I don't know how
I
mean,
know it said it actually on the ticket.
Yeah, because I mean, it's a permit issue, right? The original reason why they tried to, you know, haul me off to jail again, right? But
but you had a permit and everything. You had a permit for the show.
The building had a permit, basically. They needed an event permit. Remember, technically, we actually canceled the event, remember? And then the people that got us in trouble were actually the people there on Saturday. But anyways, man, I don't want to dwell on the past too much, man. At the end of the day, you know, 420
You know what it came down to? There was one of those cops, one of those four cops that tried to sequester you, was actually kind of cool. He was actually listening to me, and he saw that I was, you know, I was understanding what was going on and was listening and was ready to be a witness. And so, you know, he started listening to me, and I was basically telling, look, you know, this is not your guy. He's not the owner of the building. It's not him. You know, we're happy to do whatever you guys want to do. But, oh, is that Dave? What's that?
Bottom, call the call again, my bet. Oh, there he is.
Yes.
Hey, what's up, Dave? How's it going?
Oh, you got to hit your audio. Try hitting the audio.
Audio.
Oh, there you go.
Now I got you.
Yes. Awesome, brother.
Welcome, Dave Navarro, man. Or welcome, it's Life After Death.
Wait, whatever, you can't play David Bowie?
That's our guest theme song, man. When people come,
Dave Navarro. I mean, wait, excuse me. This is Life After Death.
But it's still Dave. Dave works. Yes. Both right. Davids.
Welcome.
Actually, wasn't David Bowie's real name David Jones?
That's right. That's right, man.
And he changed it because of the guy in the Monkees.
You know what?
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. I didn't know that.
It's crazy.
I was listening to Dave Bowie's first album, and I realized, I mean, it's so good. It's just like he was so overshadowed by the Beatles during that period of time. It was like 1968.
His really early stuff is very, very strange.
It's bizarre, but it's very him. But it's like a '60s him. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I just love the development of his whole artist career, man. And I mean, it's kind of like yours, man. I mean, from rock star to street artist, man.
Well,
one
of the things I love about David Bowie, and it's funny you bring that up, because actually Teacher was there last year when we put on a show and we played all of Ziggy Stardust.
Yeah, I was there too, man.
Oh, you were there too? Okay. Yeah, man. And it was all to benefit mental illness, and, well, not to benefit it, but to provide funding for those who suffer from mental illness. And we chose David Bowie because he just constantly reinvented himself and constantly kept pushing himself. And it's funny you say that, because that's one of the things I loved about him the most, is that you never know what he was going to do next. And, you know, he kept pushing the envelope. Even doing stuff that he knew wasn't going to be massively successful, like Tin Machine and some of the drum and bass records that he made were just like because he wanted to.
He's still coming out with new music, actually. I think he just released some new music this year. You know,
he might be the first. He might be the first to actually compose an album after death and release it.
Yeah.
Hey, well, listen, Dave, happy 420.
Oh, that's right, 420.
Yeah, I was just telling James Dave earlier. I decided to make an announcement today. I'm gonna stop smoking weed.
Good for you. How come?
Well, you know, I'm 51 now. You know, I just got a lot of things going on, and I'm kidding. April Fools.
actually recently have stopped quit smoking weed.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. I stopped smoking it. Primarily, well, one of the main reasons is because in this day and age, I don't want, anytime I cough, I'm convinced I'm dying. You know what I mean? And I do not need to fuck around my lungs. And I also do not need the paranoia that can sometimes come along with it, where I will convince myself I'm coming down with the roan. You know what I mean? I don't need that shit.
That's true, man. Lately, it's every single time I smoke and I get a little bit paranoid, I'm like, oh shit, is it a dry cough or is it a wet cough? Oh, there's phlegm in there. That's good.
So you know, I noticed that the last couple of times I was at your place, I didn't see you smoking anything.
No, and, I mean, people are welcome to. I just feel like for me, it's just not, it's not good timing. You know what I mean? And it just, what have you guys been doing? I mean, Teach, I know you've been getting up and doing a lot of stuff, but like, how has this whole environment been for you guys?
Well, we're going to be asking you that same thing, but since you asked first, for me, it sucked at first because I was in the middle of an artist residency at MRG Fine Art. I was going in 5 days a week from 12 p.m. to 5 p.m. getting some of the, and painting, actually painting on canvases, something I haven't done in a while.
So and funny it was you should say that, yeah.
Good to flex those muscles again. Yeah. And people were coming by and visiting, and it was amazing. And then I basically had to call it off. I had to shut it down. Yeah. I was going to be having a show after that. I'm putting my book together. The book was going to be right after that. So for me at first, it sucked. But, you know, and homeschooling the twins on top of that.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
But at this point, we've adapted. And, you know, I've actually done some of my best pieces of street art, or pieces that have been covered the most.
I mean, and, congratulations on all that coverage, man. Did you see that coming or did you, I mean,
I figured it would get a little bit, you know, maybe some local pop because the royal couple lives here now.
Yeah.
But I didn't see it getting on people.com and
no, I know. It was great.
Cover and stuff. It's just, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, it took me a couple hours to cut the stencil. It took me about 10 minutes to put it up and that was it, you know, and here it is 2.5-3 weeks later. You know, and still getting accolades from it. It's just kind of weird. You know, it's like something that I did only took this long. And, you know, and when I look at how much time I've spent on all the other stuff I've done.
Right.
You know, but this is like next, one thing. This is
the
like
next question
golf.
Is, when are the prints available?
I'm not going to do any prints. Not going to do any prints. I'm not going to do prints of the prints.
Very good. Very good.
I'm going to shut up now. Anyway, so, dude, what has it been like for you?
Man, in some ways, it's been obviously, apart from just the devastation that's been going on in the world and having to kind of wrestle with that, you know, it's, artistically, it's forced me into trying to, you know, I have to, like you brought up, canvases and stuff, I've been having to force myself to work on canvases, which is something I really don't like to do and I never really did, and so it's kind of pushed me creatively in that sense. As you know, the streets are pretty wide open and dead, and so I've still been able to do some work on the streets, you know, safely with gloves and masks and the whole deal. But it's tough, man, because it has, believe it or not, I mean, I used to have a multitude of work to do. I used to have a lot of jobs, you know.
And I know, dude. Getting you to go out with you on a night with, or come by and hang out, it was like, okay, maybe a week after next, I'm home for like 3 days.
Yeah. You know? Now, I mean, it was a joke, but like you asked me if I was available to do this podcast, and I was like, I'm free. You know, it's like, I got nothing. But I mean, I'm with everybody else. I have no source of income. I've got no future work lined up. Everything I do involves massive groups of people getting together. You know what I mean? And that's dead until the fall of 2021, they're saying.
Yeah, man, that's kind of scary, man, especially for musicians and events and things like that, man. Like, I mean, I heard 2022 is like when they're comfortable bringing like concerts back. I mean,
that's news to me. The last I heard was 2021, man. I wouldn't be surprised. And so now everybody's scrambling to try and figure out this virtual way to do it. And I'm just, no one's going to spend $50 to see something on YouTube.
Sorry, I got, but the cat, I just found the cat in the garage. Something's been making noises. I've been like, so excuse me, I got to put the cat out.
Do you think?
You know what, Dave? It's kind of interesting because I think there's some mediums that kind of will work in terms of doing it virtually. And then some mediums like stand-up comedy, let's just say. You can't do stand-up comedy to an empty screen. you know what I mean? Like, you need that audience.
You need the people in the room, for sure. Yeah. But, I mean, think about like, I mean, I know bands are doing virtual things, and that's cool. And, you know, they're giving it back because their fans really want to see them and all that. But it is not the same as being in a room and feeling the energy and feeling the human connection. And you know, I wouldn't want to do it, you know, personally, and I don't know who's going to buy a ticket for that, really, because there's so much content online of all your favorite bands already playing great shows. Why are you going to spend $50 to go watch them do it to an empty room? You know, maybe there's going to be another platform and another way that's going to happen. It would never sound as good. It's just, I don't know what's going to happen. So I think that I used to be a musician, and I used to work in TV, and I used to be, you know, I used to do street art as something that I just love to do. And I'm like, as a result of this, that's what I do full time. I mean, I feel grateful that I have another passion that, you know, that I have, I get to do while this is all going on, because you know how it is. I spend most of my time in the garage anyway by myself. Yeah. So it's not like, you know, it's not like I had scores of people that I hung out with all the time, but watching it go down and watching my friends suffer, and we've lost some people too. I mean, I've lost some people to this thing.
Yeah.
And there's really no end in sight that we can speak of. And the latest that I heard is that they're considering just opening everything up and just saying, hey, you know, this is, the body count's going to be what it's going to be, and the world has to move on, and everybody should just be careful.
Yeah.
And that's like a decision they're actually contemplating.
Yeah, I remember
that. That's what do you think about that, James?
I mean, it's kind of crazy because I remember that Texas governor, initially he came out and he said, like, hey, man, the economy is worse than this. As an old person, I'm willing to die for the economy.
Oh, yeah.
It was like a weird comment.
Oh, yeah. That was like, really controversial.
You know what I mean? But the thing is, like, now that there's so many people out of work and they don't have anything to do, and, like, let's just say for people like California, I mean, the body count is not as bad as New York. I mean, people are getting antsy. People, you know, restaurants can't afford to have 1 month, 2 months without cash flow, you know.
Well, you know what? I'll tell you why everyone is getting antsy is because of all the misinformation and flip-flopping information that they've been getting and timelines. If they could just say, hey, you know what? We're going to have tests to where everybody can get tested by this day, okay? After this day, once everyone is able to get tested in the area, then this phase will kick in, okay? But we haven't got any answers on testing, you know?
No. I actually believe, I mean, knock on wood, I hope this is true, but I was very, very sick a couple of months ago, and I kind of think maybe I had it. I was in bed with a fever for about a week, and I know a lot of people have had it and didn't know they had it and recovered. And hopefully that's the case, but
James and I were in Shanghai in November of last year. Now it was around during then, and we very well could have gotten it also and just gone right through it and not known. I probably could have brought it home, gave it to my wife and children, everyone in the house, and not known it back then. And because we don't have a way of being able to test, there's no way of knowing. Now, yeah, and to have a vaccine, you know, that's going to be working for everybody, there's so many different types of you know, genes and everything in different people. They're going to react differently to different vaccines. You're not going to have one vaccine that's going to work for everybody.
No.
The first vaccine they're going to come up with is going to work for most people. And so that brings you back to, okay, well, if we're not going to be able to have, you know, something be complete for everybody with this, there's always going to be a chance of someone dying. Then that's when you got to start questioning, okay, well, is it worth tanking the entire economy? You know, this is just another really, really bad flu that's very contagious. If this is what's going to be the future, then, you know, we need to start preparing for that and getting apparatuses and making it part of fucking fashion or whatever, if that's what you need to be in fashion to wear it.
Yeah.
And make that a part of it. And then there's going to always be people that don't want to do that.
Well, there's also the government is help. I mean, I guess there's this renters thing that's happening where you know, landlords are gonna waive your rent for X amount of months if you can't cover it, but you still are gonna owe it within a year. So say your rent is $1,000, and you can't pay it for 10 months. They're gonna be like, that's cool, but by the end of that year, you're gonna owe the $10,000. And people who live paycheck to paycheck are never going to get $10,000 together, and they're going to be evicted. And so what's going to eventually happen is, since there's no jobs out there because all these businesses are shut down and there's no way for anybody to make that money back, people are going to be evicted and shops are going to be closing down. And then you're going to have violence in the street, and you're going to have looting, and you're going to have break-ins, and it's going to, you know, potentially be even more disastrous and more dangerous out there. So I think that they're trying to figure out, that's why there's this option of just opening it all up and say, be careful, everybody, know that this is out there, keep your distance, wear your mask, and let's see what happens. I mean, that seems like one of the viable options that they're putting together. I frankly don't know how I feel about it. What do you think, James?
I think, you know, it's kind of crazy because the people who aren't affected by it, they don't understand like how serious this disease is actually, right? You know, because there's a lot of people protesting in Huntington Beach. There's a lot of people protesting in Michigan, you know, because these people are antsy and they don't understand, you know, they personally probably have, I can guarantee you all those people protesting, they personally haven't been affected by it. That's why they're doing that. If you look at China right now, they've opened up their economy, and it's interesting because I have some friends who are pretty well off, and I have some friends who don't have as much money in China. Mm-hmm. People who are pretty well off, I mean, they have this mentality like, oh, it's going to be okay. Like, you know, we're going to open up back the economy. The government did a good job, which I think is fucking hilarious, actually.
But those are, we have people like that here, but those are people that, you know, can live for the next 5 years on their savings. Yeah.
So my other friends who don't have as much money, they're very, very, very concerned, mm-hmm. you know, and they're very envious of us that we actually, our government is sending us $600, $1,200 or putting things in place to make things happen right now. As far as I know, the government hasn't really addressed this issue in China besides, okay, we let the economy open. I feel like they basically said, hey, we kind of weathered the worst of it. We know how to handle this now, and we're just gonna let it ride, man. Like,
but also that culture is already very familiar. I mean, they wear masks when they're sick with whatever, and have been for many, many, many years.
Yeah.
You know, so that it's not necessarily a new habit that they have to form in terms of being careful with touching things and being close to each other. Although if you look in the subways, they have no choice.
Yeah.
But it's crazy how many people there are there, but you know, it's getting to that place where it's almost like we have, you know, there are countries that have, you know, they have the apps and they have, there's fines if you go outside, and there's all kinds of rules in place that do seem to be flattening the curve there, that in this country would infringe on privacy laws and civil liberties, and I don't know how that's all going to go down here.
Yeah, I mean, I think at the end, we were talking about this on the previous episode. I think
I don't mean to make your art show about COVID, but I mean, no, that's no, what we're doing.
It's what's going on right now.
Yeah, it is what we're doing.
As artists, we have to, you know, figure out what's going on in our own minds and give our interpretations in our artwork. That's what we're supposed to do. I have mixed emotions about this because we've got so many different types of people. You know, you always get these different types of people, so you're going to have different ways of seeing this whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's like James was saying, I guarantee all these people that are out there protesting, whatever, they probably haven't been personally affected, or they're in good health or whatever. But then there's going to be people, you know, like me, who have children, and, you know, or have a family, or have someone old that's living with them that they'd like to see living a little bit longer.
For sure.
Who are going to be exactly one way. You know, and then you got these other people who are exactly the other way. You know, then there's all these people in between. Now, how do you satisfy everybody? It's fucking impossible.
No, it is impossible. And then, you know, there's the other side of it, which does affect the art community and certainly the street art community. It's the people, that's the backlash of people who have a problem with the fact that we still go out and do what we do at a time like this. And that, you know, we're putting people at risk. I mean,
I can understand if it's like a group piece, you have like two or three guys collaborating in one piece, and you're not, you know, you're all together like this or whatever, but you know, when you came, you were with me the night he put up the toilet paper guy.
Yeah, of course.
You know what I mean?
Of course.
I met you at your house. We stayed 6 feet apart. We drove there in separate vehicles, and you know, you were working on your pieces, I was working on my pieces. We never got yet where we were breathing on each other, anything like that.
Yeah,
completely safe, followed all the rules. No one else was around.
Nobody was around. That's exactly my point. And it's so funny when you see all the pieces that go up around that say stay home, yet the person who put it there isn't home.
You're just like, I put up that one of Dr. Fossey who says stay the fuck home. Well, say the F, and then I put Fossey's portrait right in there. That piece got reposted by quite a few people.
Oh yeah.
And then of course I had people commenting on that. Yeah, and this is coming from the person who put it up. You know, went out there to put it up, and I'm like, well, hey, you know what I mean? Like,
when have street artists followed the rules, guys? Okay, fuck those guys.
Well, when have they ever? But I did see a piece that said, "Stay home or do street art," which was nice to see.
Yeah, you know, especially if your street art is just you know, and that's it, and you're doing it at night when no one else is around,
and we're gloved and masked anyway. I was gloved and masked before all this.
Yeah, I was putting a piece up the other night, and I was actually in Burbank, which, stay away from Burbank, a lot of cops around there. Cop mm-hmm. stopped and everything, and he's like, hey, what's going on?
I had
my respirator on. I had my full respirator on.
Yeah.
I had a hat on and everything, and I walked over to his car. I was trying to talk to him, so I had to take the mask off to talk to him. And luckily, he was a really nice guy. You know, but you know, there I was with my mask on, with my glove and everything, doing some artwork. And luckily, he was nice enough to see that, you know. Mm-hmm. And all he said was, you know, just you know, you might want to check with the Burbank area, you know, officials, because this permit you have is for downtown, and you know, they, you know, rules might be different here or whatever.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, thanks, man. Appreciate that.
Did you finish were we able to finish the piece?
Yeah. He's like, because I looked at it and I kind of looked back at him like, you know, okay, well, what do you, and he's like, yeah, go ahead and finish, man. I'm like, well, does that mean this is going to get like painted over or whatever? He goes, no, I don't know. No. I just wanted you to know that, you know, this is different, you know, different area, and they may have different rules and stuff like that. And I was like, man, why can't more cops be like this guy?
I know. Well, you know? In the one sense, more cops should be like that in the in terms of just being like, well, especially now, I think they're really not sweating some of the low-level stuff. But on the other side of the coin, he did actually read, like, you would hope you would pull out the permit. He'd be like, okay, that's cool. But he actually sat there and read it and looked up the the county lines and made sure that it was specific to that area.
Well, on this permit that I have one permit for a box on Hollywood La Brea that I gave to Wordsmith because he lives nearby there.
Yeah.
And one on 5th and Main in downtown. So that's the permit that I carry with me.
Yeah.
And most of the time they don't, you know, but yeah, this dude was like, you know, because he had nothing better to do. It was, you know, about 10 o'clock at night. And, but you know what? It was enough information. It was enough of a document, you know, and of course, a 51-year-old white man that was able to speak eloquently. And, and like I said, I had a respirator. It wasn't like I had a little dust mask or something like that, or N95. I had the full respirator on.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's not going to take me in. They're not, they won't take you in these days.
No, I know.
Nowadays, they're not allowed to incarcerate you.
I know.
They'll give you a ticket. You got to show up for court and everything and pay and whatever. But at least nowadays, they're not going to take you in, especially now because of COVID-19. They're not going to put you in their car. All you do is go, you're like, no.
Are they even having court right now anymore? I feel like, you know, I mean.
No, I got called in for jury duty. I got called in for jury duty.
You're kidding.
I was supposed to go in for jury duty week before last. And I called in, like you're supposed to the night before or whatever, and they had a recording saying that this week has been canceled, no need to call back in. And I was like, of course, that means that it'll just happen again sometime soon. But, no courts. No court going on.
You know what, though? Honestly, on the large scale, though, if you look at how America has really most of us have stayed at home, it's pretty impressive how much people have complied, though. You know, I mean there are people protesting, but if you look at LA, it's fucking dead right now, man.
But they're protesting the lockdown order.
Yeah. In Huntington Beach, there's about a couple hundred people protesting lockdown order. I'm guessing these people are the people who lost their jobs and personally probably aren't affected by the COVID. I mean, it kind of, you know, you can set them in that bucket, I think, right?
Do you secretly want to know how many people got sick from attending the protest?
I mean, I just want to know the numbers because, like, you know, it's
got to be one. There's got to be a story. There's got to be a story. Did you see that influencer guy? I don't follow that kind of stuff. But there was some influencer guy.
Let me look it up.
I guess there's a YouTube guy who did this thing where he did the toilet licking challenge.
Yeah. We were watching that on Xvala's podcast. Yeah. We were wondering what the hell was going on. Does that have to do with COVID?
Well, he was licking the toilet to prove that he wouldn't get it, and he got it.
Oh, my God. You know what? Thinning the herd right there. You know what I mean? Thinning the herd, like, seriously.
But, I mean, that's an example.
Have you heard of this word Schadenfreude, basically? Yeah, it's a German word where it means like you actually, and it's so German actually, you get a good feeling out of bad things happening to others, basically. So basically in this case, it would be a it would be the perfect, you know, word to describe this.
My wife would know that for sure.
It makes us happy that something bad happened to him.
Yeah. You know, like I said, thinning the herd, man. At the end of the day, it's like, hey, man, you know, if you're going to lick a toilet seat, man, you're going to get it like, you know, you're asking for it, man.
Well, that reminds me of an old quote my dad used to say in the advertising field. When it came to competitors in the advertising field, he would say, it's not enough that I should succeed. Others must fail.
Damn, your dad was a shark.
He's a shark, man.
That's awesome. He's like,
success isn't enough. I need to watch other people fail.
That's like some Mad Men Don Draper shit right there.
Well, he was. From that era, you know.
That's Wall Street greed, you know, Michael Douglas.
Michael Douglas shit, for sure. What are you looking at, James? You look like you got something
ready. I'm looking at your artwork, man, because I'm trying to find the perfect segue right now to talk about some pieces, because you've done so much, bro, because since we've last been on the show, man.
Yeah.
I mean,
did you see there's a piece in there? There's a piece in there. Did you see the big wheat paste of wood? You know, the big, it's a massive. If you look in that,
I'm going to bring it up.
Okay, but if you know there, but there's one photo where there's a cop rousting a buddy of ours. In fact, I was with Cy, teacher.
Yeah.
And me and Cy were painting in an alleyway somewhere. And cops rolled, and then another dude came and he was painting, and the cops rolled up and they were hassling the guy, but they didn't want to get near him because of the whole, you know, the whole virus thing. And they were like, hey, you know, get away from there. But if he pulls up the picture, you'll see the best part. The best thing is that we got wood in the background. Are you seeing the picture, James?
Yeah, I'm going to pull it up right now.
Okay, it's a little bit further down.
Okay, you're not talking about
not the one with me in it. No, not that one. Well, that one I really love. It's keep going down.
I would love to have you fill in the audience on like who the fuck that is, because it's just like an internet.
Well, I'm pretty sure they all know. It's up more. I think
it's up more. Okay, basically, yeah. For the audio people, man, what we're looking at is like, for some reason, there's this huge black dude with an enormous dick, man, that just started going viral on the internet, man.
That one up in the right.
Oh, right here. This one right here.
Oh, yes.
I'll pull it up. Yeah. Right.
This is my favorite shot I've ever had. This is...
The cop was just looking at that, probably like, dude.
But the guy he's talking to was painting some, like, you know, a beautiful mural, like a big artistic, expressive thing. And he's going, yeah, but what about that? And you can see just the scale of that thing. And I got done with that, like, maybe 20 minutes before they rolled up.
It's, you know what, I saw the other one. I don't know if you did it or I guess a jiu-jitsu vandal. We gotta have this guy on the show, man. The obey this man, this,
that's mine. Yeah, those are mine too.
First of all, I was just like, dude, I love this, man, because you know what,
I couldn't resist. I figured in the middle of this, like a laugh, people need a laugh just as much as they need to be provoked on a thoughtful level. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And, you know, like I said, I had no idea who this black dude was. Apparently, you know, he's just a dude with a big ass dick, man. This, rest in peace. Apparently he's passed away.
You haven't been inundated with pictures of people sending them to you? No,
I'm saying that once I saw... For some reason, I saw yours first, and I was like, oh, Dave's being funny. You know what I mean? That very same day, there's just so many memes coming at me. Somebody sent me a meme saying, like, oh, we found the original bat that caused the COVID virus, and somebody pasted this guy's face and this guy's dick onto the bat, basically.
He has become, like, the cultural icon of this era, to be honest with you. He's been the one – he's become the source of – I guess any kind of redeeming humor for people just in the COVID era, because, you know, that's just been going back and forth with people. I've seen pictures of him in the basket with the kid instead of ET, it's him in the basket. Like, it just, whatever you can imagine.
On the bicycle.
Yeah. On the bike, taking flight with wood in the blanket.
Is that his name, though? Wood? Because I've never actually.
Yeah.
Hey, you know what though? You've had some other pieces, man. I think if you scroll down a little bit more, you have the Xanax, the mold that basically you guys that you made.
Yeah.
So teacher, creative, man.
Hold on for a second. Well, teacher actually. Taught me how to do molds and casting, thankfully, because that's been something that's been really valuable for me to do here. And this was made out of These are actual Xanax bars.
So cool.
So what I did is I chopped them up. You know, obviously based on Invader was here. But then I was thinking about it, and like, this really is who we are. A lot of us anyway are like digitally addicted, prescription addicted little creatures. And that's, you know, and so I kind of had that concept. Needless to say, this was actually very cool for me too, because I was quitting Xanax, and this was the last of the prescription. So I only had enough to make one mold, and that's where I've been making those. And
that's awesome, man. I mean, you know what, when I first saw it, man, it's I thought that's so cool that you gave us the explanation, because I thought it was like Xanax is invading your system kind of thing, you know what I mean? There's a lot of different levels to it, man. Like
it's art. Yeah,
like
I gotta get me one of those next time I'm over.
Yeah, man.
And then
you know, I love that you have so much interaction with your fans, man, because like, you know, you're sending them out the locks, doing the candy, man, raver candy, man. I think that's super cool, man. Like, I know
people. Well, I feel like,
well, he's also doing a lot of collaborations with other artists, which is just really, really awesome. You know what I mean?
That is my favorite, because I love, you know, I never stop learning. I'll never stop wanting to learn. I'll never stop wanting to be teachable. And you know, you know, the little things like on the Etsy store that you brought up, James, and stuff, like, you know, if I do prints or if I do a painting, you know, I know that a lot of people, it's out of their price range. And especially now, nobody can buy, you know, no one's buying fine art right now. No one's buying, you know, a $500, a $1,000, whatever it is. But they, you know, if they can buy something that was handmade by you, that isn't that expensive, and they get to collect it, you know, I think that that's a really cool thing to be able to offer people. And frankly, I mean, to be even more frank, that's how I'm feeding myself now. You know, like, I really, you know, a couple $100 is food for a month or two.
Oh yeah, man. Especially if you know how to shop and shop for the right things. And yeah, I've learned to make a couple $100 spread out. I mean, we eat every single meal here now at the house, whereas before, you know, I would say maybe half the meals. And you know, when you're grocery shopping and you're having to buy all this extra food that you would normally eat out, you know, you start realizing how much more you're paying for tips, gasoline, parking, and everything. Mm-hmm. How much you can actually buy with that money.
Yeah, because Postmates is over. I mean, it's not over, but I don't do Postmates. I don't do Uber. I don't do any of those things that I used to do. And that was just, I was bleeding money. I mean, I had a good job at one point, you know, and it's, you know, I know that the perception, a big perception is that, you know, being in the business that I've been in, that, like, you know, we're loaded and we got nothing to worry about. But, you know, I'm also the kind of guy who believes that, you know, if I have it, I'd spend it. And I spent a lot of money on drugs, and I spent a lot of money destroying rebuilding a lot of my life in the old days, which was very costly. So, you know, money is tight, and any little bit that I can make to help sustain myself and my girlfriend and my home is what we're doing. But I have to consider moving. I have to consider selling stuff. I have to do all that stuff. So, you know, I do consider myself very lucky, but I'm also in the same boat as a lot of people in terms of, like, I can't stay here for a year and not have an income. There's no fucking way. You know,
nope. So just, we got the family business. We're, you know, flipping houses.
How's the house business going?
Nah. Luckily, we sold the house when we sold it, the last house that we were in. We still have one more house, but after that, we're done. we're done with the house flipping business. It's there's too many people out there doing the same thing. And now with this on, it just pretty much took us out.
And are people even buying real estate?
Yeah. Yeah. They're buying. They're still buying. But, you know, it's a lot harder to do it. It's a lot harder to get it to happen. And building right now, getting workers to show up and getting materials to show up on time. We were already having problems with that before the COVID-19.
Yeah.
So to try to go out there and accomplish something like that now, no way. No. Yeah. You gotta wait till things kind of calm down a little bit, and so that you can get building permits and, you know, plan checks and all this other stuff that comes along that takes months and months to happen. You know, now is going to take a lot longer. So, it's coming down to it.
Another thing I noticed is that, you know, the stimulus check, which is like $1,200, something like that, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, my girlfriend, for instance, her rent is, I don't know, $1,100, something like that, right? Whereas her best friend in Michigan, her rent is $450. So that check goes a long way in Michigan.
Yeah.
You know, it helps her out a lot, but it doesn't cover anybody here, barely, you know. And the fact that it's a blanketed amount and has nothing is, I think that might need to be addressed too, because people are going to be out of their homes, man. And then there's going to be a lot of exodus and travel that's going to spread more because people can't afford to be where they are. So they're all going to airports. And I mean, it's, something's got to, I mean,
I got a good friend still, that moved out of state. I mean, just because of this whole cry, he's like, I'm moving back to the East Coast for now, at least just till shit.
Who said that?
One of my good buddies, actually, you know. So it's like the loss isn't just death, the economy. It's like everybody's lifestyle is kind of changing like crazy too, you know. And I think it's at this time, it's just like kind of brace yourself, you know. What were you saying,
Dave? Are you still thinking about moving to Portland?
Yeah, that was the big plan, and I feel that's been uprooted too. I don't even want to get on a plane and go look and go through all that. And now, you know, given where we're at, I don't trust, what am I going to do? Put my house up on the market and hope people come in and you know what I mean? Like, that's just, it doesn't seem like a reality right now. You know, yeah. I wish I was able to have done that beforehand, because where I wanted to go is way off in the wilderness where, you know, very little activity takes place. And that was the dream, you know, is to have a big studio and, you know, the forest outside, and that's still within the realm of possibility, let's hope. But, you know, I definitely have to table that for forever, you know.
Well, until the time presents itself, and the time will present itself eventually, because once we get all this under control and figured out to what the new reality is going to be, the economy is going to come back. There will be, you know, future prosperity. You know, you're going to have other shows that are going to come up. You're going to have other things that are going to come along. It's hard to imagine right now.
The one show that I did.
I've been going through the same thing, dude. I've been going through like, fuck, man. You know, when is going to be the next viable time that I could have a show or release my book or whatever the fuck, you know? But, dude, it's going to come. It's going to come.
At least a book is something that someone can buy and experience on their own. Do you know what I mean? So that's a good thing. But I mean, as far as, you know, the show that I was doing dealt with cross-contamination and open wounds and bleeding.
Ink Master. Just for those of you who don't know, one of the shows that David
Ink Master was hosting.
That ain't coming back anytime soon.
Which is a tattoo show.
You know what I mean? And tattoo shops are fucking dead.
Oh, God.
Tattoo artists. Understandable, right?
Tattoo artists are hurting.
But right now, it's understandable. But at the same time, holy shit, man. When is that going to get back into order?
I mean, that's the thing. It's like, we as street artists, we get to still, you know, we're not in danger of infecting the building or the box or the wall, you know what I mean? Or it back to us. But these, you know, these are human beings and open wounds, and like, that's their livelihood. And that's what they put 30
years. Oh, I guess actually, technically, if one of us does have the Rona, you know, if we're doing some artwork on a box and we cough, you know, onto the box.
Yeah.
But if you come up to that box,
wait, don't do that.
Don't lick the box. Okay.
I've been doing this whole thing wrong.
You know, I'm kind of fortunate, man. Like, I stay home a lot, just write music, and then basically my main job was to travel and visit places. So pretty much I'm just talking to them over email, and you know, nowadays that's kind of a little bit different. But you know, I'm doing okay right now. But I think like this is a time for, I think, to people. You know, some people are still sitting at home waiting for that $1,200 check, man. Like that's the only thing they're doing right now. They haven't made any other plans because they're just waiting. You know, and if people are in that position, man, it's like, you got to stop, man. You got to get off your ass and do something, because during this time of chaos, it's a time of opportunity, man. I mean, like,
yeah, it has to be.
Yeah. I mean,
you're putting together some nice music. Like, you put together how many songs now?
Yeah, I've already wrote like a song a month, but you know, which is awesome. I think it's great, you know. But for me, I think one of the things is like, even with the paint stuff, man. I mean, we're kind of putting together, using this time to put together an opportunity, like a spray paint company. We've been putting that together for a long time, and you know, if people want to go out and paint, at the end of the day, like we want to, you know, what I'm trying to say is there's always opportunities amidst chaos, you know, and. I think that during this period of time, you know, we're launching this spray paint company, which we're gonna send you some too, Dave.
I would love it.
You know what I mean,
what's the company called?
You know what? We just came up with the name. Actually, it's called.
Oh, show them the sketch, dude. Show them the sketch.
I gotta see this. Come on.
James did this. I did a bunch of other little renderings.
Check this. Oh,
look at this.
Check this out. Okay. So
this is James.
So basically this is called, it's Go, right? Go Paint, right?
Okay.
When you turn it around, it says OG, right? Basically.
Oh, that's nice.
You know what I mean? So that's the logo basically. And, you know, we're going to do like custom, you know, we could probably get, we're going to do custom like wraparounds basically for,
are you guys going to finally perfect white?
Hey, you know what it is, Dave? Is I didn't even know that there's a problem with white, actually.
There's a problem.
Well, you know what? White, if you would like, could be your color. We'll give you your own can. You design the can, except for the, you know, the Go logo will be on the one side. You'll have the rest of the can to design. Or maybe we'll let you design the whole thing and put the Go logo in there.
Teach Eric to design the wraparound, too.
I just mean a white that doesn't just spatter and is inconsistent.
You know, the cool thing is, man, I'm a chemist, and I work with a bunch of chemists. So the main thing a lot of times is, like, people aren't really focused on what kind of paint. You know, I mean, they're focused on the outside. They're focused on, you know, how much margin they can make, man. The cool thing is that it's all these artists that we're working with, man, and then – it's like, hey, if we have Teacher Black and we have Dave Navarro White or Risky Red.
Life After Death.
You know,
No, just no Dave Navarro White. Like, that's gonna label. No.
I'm not even thinking about that. But you know what I mean. Like, we've been.
I'm just talking about a white that works well. That doesn't spatter and.
The company that James works with creates the acrylic that goes in all the spray paints.
Okay.
Raw material. Yeah. So actually,
oh, cool.
I'm gonna give a real quick chemistry lesson right here. Actually.
Okay. Cool. Cool.
So the white is actually a white pigment called TiO2. There's like different qualities of this TiO2 pigment. Some, you know, you get from India, some you get from Saudi Arabia, and some you get from China. So depending on the grade of how good this like white pigment is, and also the grade of the resin, if it sticks. The good thing is we have all the chemists to formulate that. And I don't really care about like how much money we're making on that. I'd rather just build up the brand so it kind of builds up the podcast. you know what I mean?
Yeah. So that sounds great.
So at the end of the day, I'm saying, like, you know, we just want to, you know, send you some paint, man. So it's,
I would love it. Do you guys have actual hard cans that are working now?
Well, we're basically working on the paint. The can's the easy part because the filler is one person that fills it into the can, and then it's a separate person that's designs the paint. So we've actually been working on this project for like over a year.
Here's a $1 million idea for you. You get, you know, those styrofoam things that people put beers in, you know, yeah. they're like get one that heats up a little bit.
Mm.
So it's already warm and your can sits in it. So when you're out in the street late at night, your cans aren't freezing fucking cold. I'm telling you.
Hey, there you go, man.
$1 million idea. You know what I mean? So it's
make a note of that, okay?
No, it's up here, man. It's up, the main thing is, you know, at the end of the day, it's like people are always talking to me, oh, yeah, you can get the can for this much. You can, you know, you can sell it for this. I'm like, look, guys, like, I'm very fortunate. We have a lot of different ways to make our money right now. I want to provide an opportunity for artists to make the money, too. I want to give artists, like, a code. You know, if you're a street artist and you have a code and somebody uses your code to buy, man, it's like, hey, I'll kick you down a margin, man. Like, you know what I mean? What I was trying to say is we got to be creative during this period of time when a lot of people are losing their jobs, man. You know?
I know. We're very, very fortunate to be able to at least have an afternoon. Like, the one thing that is, you know, apart from the chaos and the sadness and just the overall, like, global depression that's happening, you know, as artists, we tend to enjoy days off to ourselves, and we tend to enjoy having a lot of time and a lot of space and a lot of nothing to do, because that's when we do a lot of our work, you know. But I just have to adamantly oppose the Dave Navarro white pride can. Is not, I don't.
My bad, man. My bad. That's so bad.
You can't.
There's two reasons why white is not good, okay? The white supremacist thing and the cocaine thing, okay? It's like, we don't need to put that on him.
You know, I love how nobody said white pride except me. You should call it white pride.
No, because people don't know, man. You know, I know you got an assortment of fans, man. You know, the grunge scene could be pretty grungy, you know what I mean? So
yeah, but we're also one of the most accepting scenes ever. So
yeah, of course. What is it called? I'm kidding, Dave. I mean,
no, but I'm looking forward to that because I'm proud of you for doing that, and we need a good can, we need a new paint, you know.
I'm just wondering, it's like, how much does everybody really love Montana 94? How much does, I mean, people love it, right? But could it be better? The thing is, has anybody ever talked to the Montana guy? Because we all just, like, post their shit. Oh yeah, this is cool, it looks cool on a picture. But I'm just like, man, but I actually sell the resin that goes into the Montana can already, man. Like, you know what I mean? So I'm just like, this guy doesn't even know that he's using our products right now. So maybe we can formulate an even better product, you know?
I love the 94s. I really love the golds. Mm-hmm. And then who does Montana Black? Is that the German company?
See, Montana Gold. See, this is the craziest thing. Actually, it's funny we're talking about it. Montana Gold is the German company, right?
Okay, so who does Montana Black? And it's... But they're different colors, but it's, you know,
yeah. That's the company in Barcelona, basically.
Yeah,
those are the original guys.
Yeah, I love those.
So we sell to both of those guys, right?
Okay.
But the funny thing is, like, they actually have a lawsuit going, current lawsuit going on all the time, because the rights. I mean, basically, you know, there's two Montanas. Most people don't know that at all, right?
I thought there was three.
Yeah, there's Montana. No. One of the one in Spain does the black and the 94.
The 94. Okay.
Yeah, the one from Germany just does the gold, basically.
I gotcha.
You know what I mean? So
yeah.
I just think, you know, at the end of the day, it's like, hey, man, it's what color your can is on the outside, and it's marketing. You know what I mean? Like, there's a bunch of spray paint companies. There's what?
Whoa. Molotov. Teacher's so old school with the Rust-Oleum. Which,
well, dude, if I'm spraying a stencil, you don't need a fancy cap and to have the line looking a certain way. You're just spraying fill.
That's true.
And
that's
the Rust-Oleum is just half the price. So.
Yeah, but I mean, it's such a whole different kind of action to that cap.
Yes, it is.
Oh, shout out to Trusty, man. I'm getting some comments right now.
Is Ari on there?
Yeah, Ari's on there. He's saying hardcore at 94 is Spanish. Yep, that's what he's saying. And okay. Black and gold.
Oh, yeah, then there's hardcore.
Yeah,
hardcore is. So you're saying 94 hardcore and gold is.
No, black.
And black. Hardcore, 94, and black are Spanish.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think at the end of the day,
because hardcores are cool too. But yeah. Those are semi-gloss, right?
Yes. Iron lac.
That's right. I like the flat. The flat, to me, is easier to work with because anytime you have a gloss or a semi-gloss, you have to have an exact even coat over the entire area that you're spraying. Otherwise, it looks patchy.
It looks patchy, and it drips a lot quicker.
Yes. Yes. That's the semi-gloss. Yep.
But it looks nice, man. When if you get that shit on there nicely.
Oh, yeah.
It looks nice. But that's like something you paint a bike with. You know what I mean?
Are you guys concerned? I mean, because the whole COVID thing, like just inhaling more like aerosol. I mean, I remember the last time we hung out, Dave, you were like, yeah, this is like one of the main things I inhale aerosol, basically, right? You know?
I said that oxygen is like the fourth thing that I inhale.
It was I'm just saying, like, you know,
it's aerosol, nicotine, weed, vape, oxygen in that order. Now I've cut out the cigarettes and I've cut out the weed, so yeah.
Cigarettes too?
Yeah, I don't smoke cigarettes anymore either. That's why I'm glued to this thing.
Dude,
you know, most proud of you, man. Understand that's awesome, man. To quit smoking cigarettes is like a lot harder than smoking weed. To quit smoking cigarettes and weed.
Yeah.
Dude, all my respect in the world, dude. That's
thanks,
awesome.
Brother. Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I'm so glad because I was, you know, you've been around me when I'm smoking weed. I hack, like, I mean, that shit hits me hard and I hack like this, like.
It hurt to see you hacking like that.
It hurts others. Yeah, exactly. It's so bad. And so in the height of this being a lung issue, you know, and with me hacking like that, I'm grateful I gave it up when I did because I would either be susceptible or more susceptible or be convinced that I, you know, I'd be in the ER every other day. You know what I mean? And it's just,
that's happening for me too, man. I'm definitely like,
I've seen you hack a time or two, James.
I definitely like, thing, but you know what? I don't know how you feel about this, Dave, because you, as far as you know, you don't have any kids, right?
I definitely know I don't have any kids.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You know, I for some reason, I feel like as people that don't have kids right now, we kind of hit the lotto, you know, in the sense that like a lot of people, this is a disease that you're really concerned about, that you're the people who are the sickest, you know, the older people, the unhealthy people. Like, you know, at the end of the day, I feel like, it would suck. A lot of people would be sad if I die, but like nobody's dependent on me. You know what I mean? Like I'm not a parent. So it's just like, you know, it makes me feel better in my weed circle, you know, mentally.
So you're saying you feel you hit the lottery because no one would care if you died?
No, I mean, people would care, definitely.
But nobody's guys like you and me. Guys like you and me, we hit the lottery, you know? We die, nobody cares.
No, what he meant to say is that
I think a lot of people,
no one depends on Dave, guys.
No, I'm with you. I'm with you. Yeah.
I got the twins, you know what I mean? And and so, you know, for me, this is a little bit more nerve-wracking. And just staying home from school, you know, it's tough for the wife and everything, and I for, you know, doing the homeschooling. Yeah. But I got to tell you, they have not been this healthy for this long ever.
Really?
coming home. They usually come home with a cough.
Because
something like that every other week.
Yeah, schools are just petri dishes for kinds of.
It's a cesspool. It's a cesspool petri dish of a bunch of just horrible. And they're just, you know, they are actually doing that.
But one of the sad things is that I heard the domestic violence is up because people are just locked in with each other and relationships are suffering because, you know, we're so used to going out and doing our lives and then coming home and then sharing what happened or bringing new experiences and that's ended, you know? So now you're
some people are growing together and a lot of people are growing apart.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know what? Another thing is you're talking about school, Teach. I used to be like against homeschool. I feel like kids need to socialize and, you know, but now how bad public school is and, you know, how this experiences that everybody, you know, bullies and everything like that. It's kind of like since everybody's forced to be at homeschooled now, I mean, you know, the parents have way more responsibility, man. I think it's actually a good thing, man. Like,
yes. I have more contact with my kids. I love that. I love having more contact with them.
I've been watching them do stencils and stuff. It's been amazing.
Well, here's the thing. The wife, and we have a friend living with us, Dale, has been doing the academics classes with them. And, dude, they're getting much smarter now. They're getting better schooling now because they're getting one-on-one work. They love their art teacher. And I do PE with them as well, you know, so they're getting better education, and health right now than they have in their entire life.
I don't really know why there was a stigma for being homeschooled. At least when I grew up, kids like that you met that were homeschooled, they were like, oh dude, he's weird. Like, you know what I mean? He was homeschooled. I remember kids saying that about other kids. But I can't really think of like a negative about it, man. It gets the
parents. Well, here's the thing. When I was growing up, you know, we always thought, well, homeschooling, well, you're kind of sheltering your kid. You're not letting him experiencing the world and stuff, you know. But especially with my son, he has sensory processing disorder. Mm-hmm. And at school, most of the time he's getting bullied. You know, he's a big kid and everything, but it doesn't matter. You know, it's the mind and everything. Like this little kid was bullying him, much smaller than him. But he's just susceptible to it because of his mind, you know, processing disorder. And so, especially for my son, you know, I'd much rather have him here at home, you know, because it hurts me to hear stories from him coming home from school and feeling like he was bullied and his kids picking on him and stuff because they know how to pick on him and it's easy, you know. And so, at this point, knowing my son the way that I do, I'm fine with homeschooling him the rest of my life.
Yeah, one of the things that's, I guess, that, you know, a buddy of mine is, my buddy of mine sends his kids to private school. And one of the things, and it's a very expensive private school. And one of the things that they're paying for is you know, one-on-one classroom, attention. They're paying for the extracurricular programs. They're paying for socialization, for food, for whatever the school provides. But in the light of all this, those schools are not dropping the tuitions.
Oh my God.
Which is like a massive problem, right? Because all the stuff that they're quote unquote paying for don't exist anymore.
Yeah.
And then the other side is if you talk about homeschooling versus non-homeschooling is I think one of the things that people want is the ability to learn socialization with others and being able to interact with others and, you know, learn how to process and communicate and not, I don't know, and not have things be overwhelming when in the process of a real situation. And since that's gone, I worry that that's going to be gone. And
yeah, I mean,
I've already seen it in my lifetime. Being my age, pre-cell phone and post-cell phone, and I see kids that are, you know, working as you go to a Starbucks and you order something, 9 times out of 10, they really didn't hear your order and they ask you to repeat it because they're not reading it off a screen. They're not used to listening.
You're saying that the social skills have gone down since basically in each generation because people are on their cell phones too much and just kind of getting, I see that. Yeah, kids, you know, they don't know how to talk on the phone. You know, it was like, you know, you talk on a phone with a girl you like, right? You ask, hey, is this person home, right? Back in the day, like, I don't think that happens at all anymore, right? Nobody calls the house, right?
Do you remember in the old school Italy, people would meet at a cafe for coffee and sit and talk for hours, drinking these little tiny cups of coffee.
Espresso.
And today, you're like, what are they talking about for so long?
Yeah. My parents, when they got older, you know, I was like, why don't you keep in touch with your friends so much? You know, give them a call, say hi or something like that. But my parents were from that era, like you're talking about, where they would go over to their house. You know,
yeah,
and not call before they went over,
yeah,
a pop over,
yeah,
you know,
bye.
And then or they'd meet somewhere and talk face to face. And so, if they were out of town, they wouldn't call them because they know they'd be back in town within a certain amount of time, they go talk to them face to face. So, when my parents got older, you know, I was like, well, why don't you call your old friends? It just doesn't register to them.
Yeah.
You know, because it's that same mindset that, you know, I'm still kind of out of town. I can't just walk over and see them. And so they never called them. You know, it's just like, it's this whole mindset of isolation because of technology. Oh, you know what? I saw, just before we got on today, I saw Todd Goodman's piece that he did with the phone and the, did you see that with the phone and the syringe in
it? No.
Yeah, just check him out. He just put it up today.
Pull it up right now. So.
He took an iPhone, and he.
Oh, Todd Newman.
Todd Newman.
Yeah.
And then put like a belt around it, like a.
Yeah, yeah.
Put around your arm to strap your arm, and he's like taking this thing and put it in, you know, a bunch of different places. But I just thought it was brilliant. The imagery that I don't know if he did it or if. Yeah. There you go.
Shot on iPhone.
Yeah, shot on iPhone. But I just thought that was really amazing. I don't know if he came up with the idea himself or
yeah.
if he was doing it for yeah. somebody. He did. Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, hey, this great reminds job, me of God. Something that I saw recently. Did you guys watch the LA Originals, the Netflix series?
I haven't seen it yet, but I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, yeah, check it out. Because there's a few heroin addicts in there that they got clean, and they showed kind of like their whole process of it's real interest, real LA too at the end, but you know, you grew up here too, Dave, you know what I mean, so it's like it really created that like vibe, man. But what about the homeless people, man? It's so crazy right now during this crisis because I see them wearing masks, a lot of them. I'm like, dude, where are these guys getting the masks? It's kind of crazy. Like
thank God they have them. I can't say where or who with, but I was recently on down at the train yard, one of the train yards, and ran into a lot of those people. And it was, I mean, I don't know if you've been to the train yards at night, but it's dark and it's dangerous and it's a little scary. But you know, there were lots of people painting, and then there were a lot of homeless people. Everybody was just fucking cool. Like, you know, usually you run into somebody or there's like
there's an argument
or a homeless person who's like screaming about socialism or whatever, but there was none of that, you know what I mean? And everybody was masked up, everybody was like, are you good? Yeah, I'm good. And everybody was super respectful. I mean, it's like it's the thing has infiltrated itself into even into the saddest parts of our society, which is
all parts of society.
Yeah, the homeless community, they're even there. They're, you know.
Oh, you know what I wanted to mention? One of the reasons why I have this piece up right here. Mm. This is part of my Earth Day piece. But it seems that one of the heroes, in addition to the people in the medical business and the doctors and nurses and everything, they're amazing heroes with the virus, but dogs, a lot of the shelters have emptied out because people have come and adopted dogs.
That's amazing.
Time. Yeah, now, silver lining, I guess.
That is one of the silver linings. But at the same time, I'm just hoping that those people that have adopted all those dogs don't have a plan set up for when they go back to work.
Yes.
Because it's going to break my heart if once this restrictions start easing and everything, if all of a sudden these dogs start end up back in there.
Yeah. Respect
the dogs. You know what I mean? Thank God for them. They're heroes. Some of the heroes of this COVID-19 as well. But, you know, if you're going to adopt them, please have a plan for after this goes back to normal.
Speaking of dogs, I don't know. James, have you been to my house before? You have, right?
Yeah.
Hey, we're going on a ride.
Have you seen this dog?
Oh, yeah.
This is Rasco.
Yeah, that's my buddy Dave.
Yeah. I remember that guy.
Yeah, he's a good-looking
LA
dog.
LA Blue.
But dude, Dave has some of the dopest pieces. I mean, I walk in and there's like Andy Warhols everywhere. You know what I mean? I'm like floored, man. Oh, there's a Chaka on the back. That's awesome, man.
Which one? Oh, yeah. Chaka just came over here the other night.
Awesome. Yeah. Oh, dude.
And then he's right below Chaz, if you see Chaz up there.
Yeah, right at the top there. That's awesome.
There's a little
my cat.
You know what? Vile gave us a great idea of
show him the vial. Show him the vial you have at your house.
The vial. Vile was not happy that there are other pieces bumping his.
Of course not.
I love it because right there, man. Yeah.
And I think when Cy hit it up here,
yeah,
I instantly got a text from Vile. Is Cy bumping my motherfucking piece? and then there's a collab that Cy and I did.
Oh, it's awesome, dude. That is so cool. I love that.
Dude, that's, you know what? Seriously, Dave basically has a museum inside his house, man. If you said you're going to try to sell your house, man, I think there's, you know, just the art alone is worth way too much money, man. You're going
to
need.
No, I know. I mean, the problem with that is that I don't want to. And the original plan was to like hang on to it and have it turn into something that could be of help to somebody in the future and then move to Portland. But obviously
Do you have a place in New York too?
No, I don't. I used to spend a lot of time out there because I work. So that's another thing I really miss is, you know, I had a whole community of people I worked with in New York.
Yeah.
And so I miss, you know, having that side of my life, you know, being thwarted. But we'll get it back. I mean, I have no doubt that we're going to be able to get it back.
Yeah, I just, you know, the whole thing that just scares me is just, I feel like definitely like people will start to loosen up on, you know, the whole COVID thing. But, you know, events not coming back until end of 2021, 2022. I mean, for artists and music, I mean, especially musicians, man. I mean, musicians aren't known to save money. Like,
no, but think about this. You know? I just saw a report and I guess this all falls under the umbrella of arts. So we're still on topic, but even like Broadway shows that were in production for like 2 years and sets being built and casting and rehearsals and those are squashed. Like people who had all these films that were in production, not that we should feel, you know, it's like, yes, there's more people suffering than like actors, but I'm just saying like the amount of heart and work and years of energy every single day of just devotion to a craft to put something together are just, they're never going to see the light of day.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just so many people and my, you know, a girl who works with me is an actress and she can't apply for PPP because she's not on some kind of payroll. She can't apply for unemployment because she doesn't have the, you know, enough of the 10, what are they, the receipts? Yeah, she doesn't have the work history, exactly. The 1092s, or what are they called? 1099s, yeah. So, I mean, there's a number of people in my life, very close people, that are just fucked. And, you know, so
I think some, there is, like you were saying earlier, there's a large number of people that are not going to recover from this. It's going to be a completely different life for them. But on the other hand, when you go through something like this, and you know, could take a full another year or so to get full control of it and some idea of consistent normalcy or consistent reality. But once we get to that other side, it's going to be like going through any horrible event that you've survived. It's going to make you stronger, and it's going to prepare you for anything.
Well, what I mean, this
type of thing is never going to happen again the way it happened.
No, and what my hope is that just on a global level, that all the nations are going to finally start to see us as earthlings and not people of different nations, because you know, we're just earthlings, and it doesn't matter where you're from, and it just, we're all,
I mean, dude, if the Palestinians are calling a fucking truce, I mean, no, we must die honorably, not by this damn virus, we must kill each other honorably.
Yeah.
I mean, that's saying a lot, you know. Yeah. Like, let's call a truce because we don't want to die from the virus. We want to die in honor of shooting and killing each other.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just hoping
it's never going to stop. By the way, you know, but
I feel like, you know, they could start a new way of thinking in terms of that we're all just as vulnerable as the next guy. It doesn't matter who you are, where you live, what country you're from, and that we need to start. I mean, people always talked about how a globalization of some kind of new world order is this big scary thing, and I'm not sitting here saying we should do that, but what I am saying is that spiritually that would be a really great thing for us to all recognize that.
Yeah. You know what, I think it would be a good idea that when we hit, call it DEFCON 4 with a virus, that everything shifts into globalism. You know what I mean? Like, as soon as the WHO or whatever says, you know what, we've just identified a pandemic possibility crisis. Mm. It is time now to shift into globalization. Everybody knows what the fuck to do, and they shift into it, and we take care of it like that.
Yeah. You know,
you're right.
Thinking about this new world order, I mean, they've been, since I can remember, they've been worrying about that, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like,
they're really taking their time.
Old rich people. Any of these old rich people who have spent billions and billions of dollars to get control that they have of the economy and everything and the politics in the United States, yeah, they're shitting themselves.
You know,
but I mean, it traces back to the Priory of Sion, which is like the 1700s. Like, when are they going to get it together? Like, you know, now's a good time.
Well, you know, hey, Dave, like, I don't know. You know what? If you, it's so funny because those people are in the same line of the conspiracy theorists, right? You know? And we've heard some really crazy conspiracies going on. And
there are people saying that this is a conspiracy.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So the latest thing I saw is that there were a bunch of articles or things on this on Fox News where they're talking about doing investigations into the development of the virus in Wuhan. They're still trying to prove that they're trying to say it was developed in a lab. But there's already been enough testing to show that was impossible, that it had to come from a bat.
That's what I heard.
But you know what?
Trying to push this fucking narrative that it was, you know, made in a laboratory? That'll all start petering out soon, and it'll go back to where it was with, they didn't make it in a lab. It came from a fucking bat, and... You know, that's another thing that's kind of scary is that from what I heard, the wet markets is where the bats came from that they're eating.
Yes.
So, but you know what? Here's the thing, man. I think just like in the time of 9/11, whenever trauma, like crazy, something like this happens, there's so much misinformation going out there right now. It's all like, how much do we actually know? And how much is just something that we heard?
Exactly.
You know, because now I'm hearing, oh, you know, they never even sold bats at the wet market. And, you know, but I'm also hearing COVID-19 is caused by 5G. You know what I mean?
I heard that one too.
They're blowing up towers in London. They're blowing up phone right? towers.
Well, I also, the newest one is that the reason why there's social distancing and the 6 feet apart from each other is that they're trying to teach us to live that way so satellites can track us better.
You know, yeah, there's just
that's a pretty good one.
You know what,
Big Brother,
at the end of the day, Occam's razor, right? It's probably just a pandemic, you know.
Yeah, but the fact of the matter is like, when they passed the Patriot Act like 20 years ago, they know exactly where we are and what we're doing, and they get into any committee's computer. So it's like, that's just a non-starter.
It's always
you know what, though? Occam's Edge, which you just mentioned, James, is probably very much the case. For those of you who don't know, Occam's Edge is basically all it says is that, you know, the
most logical
evidence is what
is most likely. Yeah.
Yeah.
The simplest explanation is the most likely explanation, you know. So if ever, you know, people have been, I was just saying, back to 9/11. When crazy things happen, man, people want to find a way to cope and somebody to blame a lot of times, I think. And, you know, what's easier to blame than the government a lot of times? I mean, we're still blaming them for, even if they did the best job, we would still blame them, period. Because it's like, it's just, they're just easy to shit on. You know what I mean? And then now we want to
target,
you know, we want to put, you know, why, you know, people are dying on top of, and they want to add it to, you know, I've even been told that Kobe died because he was trying to save us from the vacciners, the 5G people.
Wow. That,
no joke.
That
no right joke. It's okay.
Be the craziest one I've heard so far.
No joke. Okay. So at the end of the day, what I'm just trying to say is like, you know what? I think I just really feel for people right now. I feel like people are like really hurting, and I get it, man.
Yeah. The only thing I would ask, and that I don't know the answer to this, is that, Is the mad dash for a reason of where it started have anything to do with, if they can figure out where it started, then they can figure out a cure better?
That's or is point. It? Yeah. It's a blame game, I think. Yeah.
Or if somebody's already got the virus, doesn't that come from the blood cells of somebody who already has it, and how they learn how to mutate that and use that to our advantage? Because when you get the flu shot, they're injecting the flu into you.
Yeah. Yes.
Exactly.
So,
you know what's crazy? Like, they've been doing, I saw this picture of a old Chinese man like blowing with a long straw. They used to grind up smallpox, and then they would give you small amounts of it, trace amounts, so you can build immunity to it. It's just so crazy how disease works, man. You know, and let's just talk about this real quick. It's really interesting because everybody's talking about manufacturing during this period of time. Like, a lot of the medicine, man, it's crazy. It's made in, a lot of it, the precursors are made in Asia now, man. And so it's like, there's just like a power grab right now, because people start evaluating like, hey, man, all our manufacturing is gone. Even, you know, our precursors of antibiotics or medicines and all that kind of stuff is gone, man. If a real pandemic hits, if we don't work together, I mean, if the enemy is making all of our precursors of antibiotics, like, you know, I mean, it's probably not a good idea for us to get into a war with them. And so it just makes, I think this whole pandemic, man, it's really made me and everybody, I think, evaluate like, hey, man, like, you know, things have been really, really good for a really long time.
Which feeds into my necessity for spiritual globalization, know, because we're all, it doesn't matter where they're dying just as much as we're dying, whether they make this shit there or not, you know. So let's help ourselves, you know, recover and thrive,
dude,
you know. And Teacher and I are both working on this Earth Day thing. That's tomorrow, actually, is Earth Day. A lot of people don't know that because they're so caught up in this whole thing, but, you know, here's the thing about Earth Day. The Earth is going to be fine. The Earth is going to be here for billions of years. It's ourselves that are at risk. You know what I mean? The Earth has lasted through six extinction events, at least. You know what I mean?
Dinosaurs, bro. You know?
The Ice Age, the fucking comets, the volcanoes, whatever's happened, you know, the Earth has lasted. So when
it'll get you back.
Yeah.
The earth will get you back.
The earth will be fine. I'm just saying, like, what we're really at risk of losing is ourselves.
Yeah, man.
You know, so because it'll clean itself.
You know what, man? I think it's been. That's a great. I just want to end it there because I feel like it's a good point, man. You know, and you know, thanks so much, Dave, for for coming on, man.
I just appreciate. This is my first Zoom thing since this pandemic was started. I enjoyed it, and thanks for having me. I'm sorry I didn't stay focused on art so much, but nice to
bounce around. This is one of the things that we like to do with this podcast is just to kind of riff. You know what I mean? Because otherwise it's not organic. You know, then it becomes very structured. You got, okay, these are your questions. Will they be expecting some answers from them? Okay.
You know, I think I think, you know, as your tattoo show is probably going to be gone for a little bit, you know, we've been talking about a show with Teach. I mean, travel's going to be gone for a little bit, obviously, but I think, you know, we're talking about doing some street art shows where, basically teaches like Bourdain, goes around to a different city.
Well, you know what? Here's an idea. Maybe if you're down for it, Dave, maybe we have you come in and guest host some of those shows.
Yeah, man, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I just love hanging out with you guys. So it's a lot of fun.
Cool, man. Well,
I was ready to give you my my history and the early works of Egon Schiele being a massive influence. And
you should go on the Professor Jim's show talk, man, because then you could at least me, man, I'm a dummy for art, man. I'm just like a fanboy for your guys' stuff, man.
Well, so, you know what? Vile actually mentioned that. You were talking about that earlier, having episodes where we have artists that we've had on before come on and talk about what they've got in their bag. You know, what has inspired them for whatever it is they're working on and everything. So we'd love to have you back on for another episode for What's in Your Bag.
Oh, yeah, that'd be killer.
Idea by Vile.
People would be very surprised what was in what I grew up on and stuff. So, yeah, that'd be fun. All right, guys. Have a great day. Stay safe. And teacher, I'll see you out on the street. Let me know when you go do your thing, and maybe I'll join you.
Awesome, take care, brother.
All right, peace.
Thank you.
Bye.
Peace. And in